Better?
Oh, let me see here.
Yeah,
Oh,
better.
yeah, they are saying like they can just hear me and oh, yeah, it's not good, man. You have to go outside.
You have to go outside. So how did you get into the King's Cup?
King's Cup. So I was fighting a lot in Virginia, thank you. I was fighting a lot in Australia for WMC, Mr. Fox. And he's like, Cosmo, we have, like, of course, the one of the biggest shows in Thailand is the King's Cup. Mm-hmm. But you have to do some tournament. If you win the tournament, I put you in the King's Cup. I was like, okay, that's fine. So I was in Australia against, it was like a tournament, three-fight tournament. First fight was Zabar Akhirov. Remember Zabar?
Can you hear me?
Yes, yes, yes.
All right.
Do you remember him? Zabar Akhirov?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Was my first fight. My second fight, I won by points. My second fight was against Johnny Poor, and I won by TKO. And my third fight was against the Thai guy, Mark Sua, and I won by points. So I won the tournament, and then I went to fight in the King's Cup in Thailand.
Damn. That is like a fucking roster of guys to go through just to get to the King's Cup, bro. Those guys are all hard hitters, very fucking well accomplished fighters too. And they, I would have to say, a lot of those guys were at their peak performance at the time you fought them as well. How old were you at that time?
27.
And who did you fight in the King's Cup?
My first fight was against a guy from Iran. My second fight against Naruepo Fartex.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, my first fight against the Iran guy, the ref stopped the fight because I was hurting him bad. So the ref stopped. The second fight, I won by Naruepo Fartex by KO. And the third fight, I fought Matsu again, the same guy I fought in the tournament, yes. But in the King's Cup, I won by KO. So, yes, was good, man.
So doors must have opened for you after the King's Cup, right?
Yes, like in Thailand, was like I was fighting like a Thai guy, you know, like I was fighting everywhere. I just need to see like first about the weight, because like if I was going to fight like a Omnoi, the fights are early, you know, like it's not at night, so I couldn't make the weight they had, so like I couldn't fight on Omnoi. Channel 7 was like, I think 3 o'clock would be kind of like a hard, depends the weight, you know. So I was fighting a lot. Like, I fought on Lupini, I fought the Raja, and I was fighting a lot on TV. That's why people know me there like a lot, because I was like fighting, I was on TV, you know.
What kilo? 70 kilos? 77 kilos?
I was fighting there 160 pounds, 100. Like, oh yeah, around there, 160. Most of the fights were 160, like 72.5.
Okay. So after the King's Cup, you went to Showtime?
Yeah, so after I was there in Thailand, I was good there, man. Like, I didn't need to leave. But I started thinking, like, bro, I need to start, like, doing business in another place. Because Muay Thai, I was making money to live in Thailand. But I started thinking, like, if I go back to Brazil right now, I have no money because box is bad, you know? Like, if I change, it's bad.
Yeah.
So, like, I need to make money, you know? Like, I need to make money. So, like, in Thailand, I knew I couldn't make, like, enough money to go back to Brazil with some, you know, some money. So, I was like, you know what? I will start fight kickboxing because I know it's more money kickboxing. And then I started talking with a friend of mine who was living in Holland. And I was trying to find the right gym, you know, to train, because they have a lot, like a Mike's gym, the Mejiro, so many gyms there. So these guys said, Cosmo, it's not just because I train in Mike's gym, but I never heard nobody saying bad things about money against Mike.
Right.
I was like, oh, yeah, that's, you know, good point. And then I went to live there. And I remember the beginning was hard, bro. It was like bad because when I got there, like I don't know how many months I had to wait because all the Showtime card was like full, right?
Wow.
I was waiting full. And I was like, I had to wait, but can you imagine? I was making baht in Thailand. And then I was paying in euro. I was like,
yeah.
You know, I had to do something. And then, like, I had opportunity to fight on It's Showtime. I don't remember against who my first fight. I don't remember. But anyway, okay. My first fight, I was against Mirto. You know Mirto, he fights now on the Glory. Yeah. So I won that fight. And then I think I fought Nikki and I lost by points. It was a really good fight, like Thai, really close fight. And then my third fight was against Shakuta. He was the champion. And then I won because I knee him in the face and I opened his face. And then I won the belt. It's Showtime, 77 kilos, was 170 pounds. And then I fought in another guy in Hungary. And then I won the knee in the face too. I opened his face again, another guy. Yeah, and then in the end of the year, I should make a fight to like defense the belt, but I didn't want to fight. But and I had like it was 15 days after the King's Cup.
Right.
Right.
I heard about that. Yeah.
Yeah. So like I said like I have to fight. You know, I have to fight. And it's like no. If you fight, you take your belt. Okay, right. That's fine. You can take my belt. Like you guys are not paying me good, so that's fine. So I went to fight in Thailand in the King's Cup, and they took my belt. But I was like, I never fought like because like oh I want this belt, you know. I just that time I was fighting for money, of course, and because I like it to fight. And of course, I prefer to fight in Thailand in the King's Cup much more than just fight the kickboxing at Showtime.
Really?
So and
you decided to fight in Thailand over fighting kickboxing in the Netherlands, but weren't you making a lot of good money in the Netherlands versus the baht in King's Cup? So can you explain what made the decision to fight for the King's Cup versus to defend your Showtime belt?
Because the King's Cup was something about like feelings, like, you know, like about like, it's like fighting my home. I was like, man, I'm in Thailand. I want to fight in Thailand. Mm-hmm. And of course, Muay Thai for me, I was, the first thing to, if I had to choose Muay Thai or kickboxing, I always fight Muay Thai. Of course, if the money from the kickboxing was good, really good, I had no choice, so I had to fight. But wasn't good, you know,
really?
Like wasn't like enough because they are. I think you know, It's Showtime made a reality show in Thailand. Remember?
Yes.
I fought and I went to the final. And I lost the final. I won in Thailand all the three or four fights. And I went to Holland to fight the final. And I lost by points. Mm-hmm. So my contract from It's Showtime was because this show. It's not because like, okay, let's do a new deal. You know, like, and you fight here. No, it wasn't about that. It was because it was the money from the fights. I don't remember how much money was that. I think it was... I think I won like 10 fights, $5,000 each fight was the price. You know, like if I won the tournament in Thailand, I would make $10,000 for 5 or 10 fights, but I got second. So I had like 10 or 5 fights for $5,000. That was the purse. And in Thailand, in the King's Cup, I think I was making more. You know, I think I made more in 2009. I don't remember, but it was something like that. And I was, of course, I want to fight in Thailand. I want to fight the King's Cup.
Right.
And never, nobody won the King's Cup twice, two years in a row.
Right.
You know? So I was the first, and then I could make that happen. But in the final, I won my first two fights. And in the final, I lost I lost your C-class.
Yeah, but I think that was a big deal. That kingdom was huge. I think that was a very big matchup for you as well internationally for people that love Muay Thai around the world. Because Showtime, in my opinion, it was known in the United States, but it was hard to watch because we didn't have the technology to see it at that time, you know? Barely in YouTube, barely international shows, but we were getting news about foreigners fighting for the King's Cup. And I know that that was a loss to Yotsen Klai, who I remember you telling me the hardest hitter that you have ever faced in your life. Is that right?
Yes. Like crazy. He puts like a horse, bro.
Okay, so after the King's Cup, did you go to Lion Fight right away?
No, after the King's Cup in 2010, I was living here in the West already because I went to Brazil in 2009. And I was talking with a friend of mine, and he's like, man, you should fight MMA, you should fight MMA. And I was like, oh, man, it's not my thing, you know? He's like, bro, I think it's the best thing to do to make some money, you know, like fighting for real, make some real money. It was like, yeah, maybe. So I was thinking to fight MMA, and the same thing I did with Muay Thai and kickboxing, I did with MMA. Because when I thought, like, oh, I have to to learn how to fight real Muay Thai, I went to Thailand. And then, like, oh, I have to learn how to fight kickboxing for real, like, good kickboxing. I went to Holland. And then when I was thinking about MMA, of course, I was thinking about wrestling. Because, like, you know, like, I had to learn, the wrestling. I was like, there is no way I have to go to America. I have to live in America. So I came here in 2010. And I don't remember when my first fighter was Lion Fight. I remember I started fighting for Bellator first. And then I left Bellator because they didn't let me fight Muay Thai anymore.
Really? How come? So,
yeah, because like the contract, we didn't sign anything about that. It was just like, you know, oh, yeah, okay, Cosmo, you can fight Muay Thai if you don't have any MMA fight, like, close, you know. So that was the deal, not in the paper, just here. So I wasn't fighting that much, and I asked them, listen, I want to fight Muay Thai. He's like, no, you don't fight. And then, like, you know, so that's why I started, like, fighting with the ex-president president from Bellator. And, yeah, and then after a while, I did my fights. I did all my fights on Bellator. And, yeah, I think after that, I fought on Lion Fight after that.
I think you fought Lion Fight 2011. That's when you fought Cyrus.
So, yeah, I did one fight. And then after this fight, I think they didn't let me fight anymore. It was something like that. I wasn't fighting enough like Muay Thai, you know, the way I want.
And then you fought Sakmo Cole, which was also another kind of like a controversy of how you lost that one too.
That was a joke. That was a joke. Like, of course I don't want to fight. I break his arm. My second kick in the fight. I kick it with the right. I don't know how to kick it with the right, but I just close my eyes and kick it. So like, I break his arm. And he got like 14 sticks here. I elbowed him like so bad here. And I remember when I went to the restroom, rather than the locker room, he's like, he went there and like, Cosmo, you know, like, I know you won the fight. But okay, no, that's fine. He's like, it's not your fault, you know? It's the ref's fault.
Right.
So I remember that after that, I like, I will not fight here anymore. So, right. Yeah. But what's good? What's good, like, fight a lion fight?
Then you also fought Nampon, PK Stereo, and then you went on fighting Joe Nanawat. That was a really crazy fight. That was a very high-level fight with Joe Nanawat. What are your opinions about that fight with Joe?
I wasn't prepared to fight. I was surfing. I was in Indonesia surfing. I was like, I'm serious. I was 14 days in mental-wise surfing. And then when I that is like, without stepping the land, was just on the boat for 14 days. And then when I get, like, I was going to take the plane to go back to Brazil, I remember Christine from Lion Fight, she messaged me like, Cosmo, we have a fight for you. I was like, oh, okay, that's fine. Like, I want to fight. And she's like, oh, but it's next week. I was like, next week? I have to go back to Brazil? I was surfing like 14 days, just surfing. And it's like, but can you do it? For against who? It's like against a Thai guy. I was like, oh, damn it. But okay, I can't fight. So I went to Brazil. I got in Brazil, I think it was Wednesday or Thursday. And I did two trains. One train was really bad. My cardio was really bad. The second train, my cardio was a little bit better. And I think, I don't know if I did one more train, but I can't. I flew to America to I don't know if it was Vegas. No.
I think it was East Coast.
Yes, well, East Coast, yes. And I did, I think, one or two more trains the week to cut weight. And then I fought.
Damn.
Yes, it was a good fight, but it was a good fight.
Do you think the outcome would be different if you faced him again in at one?
I think so. It's hard to say because fight is fight, you know. Like maybe if I was like too much focused, like training a lot, blah blah blah, and then like I can't like you know relax and fight. But at that time, I knew my cardio wasn't that good. But I was just like fighting without pressure, you know. Like I'm like I was surfing, man. Like you know, I just went there to fight and have fun. It was like okay, I go fight. There's no problem. So maybe I don't know. Could be different, maybe.
So talking about one, how did you get into the one championship promotion? Because I know they started building a lot of fights. They started signing a lot of high-level athletes, and it was really good for Muay Thai. They signed a lot of great Muay Thai boxers. How did you get involved with ONE Championship?
The commentator, how his name? Esquivello, something. I don't know his name, but he always like on TV, like talk about the fights. He mailed me on Twitter. He messaged me on Twitter and like, hey, Cosmo, ONE Championship wants to talk to you to make like a deal, you know? It was like, okay, that's nice. I was living in Brazil and I didn't know anything about ONE Championship. That's the truth. Like in Brazil, nobody knew about like ONE Championship. Like ONE Championship, ONE Championship has a Brazilian champion there, Adriano Moraes, I think. And nobody knows him in Brazil. You know, so the show in Brazil was kind of like small. It's kind of like a normal show in Asia, you know. But I thought I had like make a good deal, you know, with the purse and everything. Because I told them I could fight Muay Thai, kickboxing, MMA, and we made a deal, and that's it. It was good. But after a few months, I started like checking what they are doing, and I saw they are like really big names going to fight in ONE Championship. It was like, man, I think it was, you know, like I did a bad deal, bro. Like, because it's like this, Jeff. I know you train Muay Thai and you are good, you know. So I tell you, like, hey, man, I have a show here in Florida. Do you want to fight? And it's like, yeah, Cosmo. For listen, you know my show, right? It's like, oh, yeah, I know. And you think like, oh, that's a medium show. That's okay. And then I pay you like, okay, I'll give you like 2,000, just example, 2,000. And then after 4 or 5 months, I have like a lot of big names here, like Yotz and Clyde, Petrosian, like, and you have to fight them for $2,000. You know, like, you know, like I understand I made the contract. Nobody like forced me to do this contract. But it's kinda like unfair to make me fight for the same purse. Like, okay, I'll give you an example. The money I made my first fight was against the guy from Australia. I made the same money fighting Nick Holmes, and he's one of the best kickboxers in the world.
Yes. That's crazy.
Like, it's not fair. It's not fair. You know? So,
yeah.
And bro, so many things happened, like against my fight against Nicky. It was like, I shouldn't fight. I told them, like, I didn't want to fight. I told them, I don't want to fight. So, like, many things happened, and then I had to fight. After that, of course, was my first loss in my career like that. I never lost by KO. And then, of course, I was mad. I was upset about the situation. And then they asked me to fight Sage. I didn't know who was Sage. I still don't know. I was training in Brazil, and I came here to help Anderson Silva in his camp in California.
Mm-hmm.
And but when my coach here, he went to the airport to pick me up, I told him, listen, man, I think I will fight MMA. He's like, oh, guess who? I don't know, man. He's like, Sage, Sages. I don't know. I don't know who is that guy. He's like, Sage North, good. Yeah, you know him. And then he's like, are you serious, man? Everybody knows him here in America. It'd be a good fight for you if you win. And I know you can win this fight. It'd be good for you because you are moving to America again. I was like, oh, man, I didn't know. He's like, man, he was from UFC, blah, blah, blah. So it was good. Like, I went to California. I spent, like, 1 month with Anderson. And then I come back here to Florida to start doing my camp. It was just, like, my camp was just me, my Muay Thai coach, and my wrestling coach. Like, and just a few students to help me with the wrestling. And then I went to fight. After my fight against Sage, and I talked to them, listen, we have to talk about my deal because I'm not happy at all with that. And they said, no. And then we start fight from there, you know. They asked me to fight Okami in Tokyo after that fight against Sage for the same money. And I thought, no, I'll not do that. You know, like the difference now, the difference about fight Okami and fight Nicky was because when I fought Nicky, I was living in Brazil. So I had to fight because I wasn't making money at all in Brazil. Right. I was just, you know. But when I moved to Florida, I don't need to fight. Fight for me is extra money, you know, right. Because I can't, the money I make like teaching here, oh, bro, I can't do any other thing. I can do Uber, and I'll make money, you know. So, like, if it's not fair, if I feel it's not fair, I will not fight.
Right. So let's talk about your contract, like, how many fights were you signed to?
Six fights.
You've had three so far with one?
Yes.
And they didn't, there wasn't anything in your contract to increase your pay. If you won, you would be able to renegotiate any type of...
No. Because it was a stupid contract. I never had a manager. Never. Like, after almost 20 years fighting, Malky is my first manager. Wow, you know? Okay. So we start talking after my fight because my wrestling coach, he's like kind of like brother, like Malky's brother, you know. They are like good friends, very good friends. I was like best friends, probably. And after my fight, I told him, listen, man, I need to find a manager because that's not good for me. You know, if not, I will just stop. I will not fight anymore. It's like, man, I know a guy. He's my best friend. And he's a John Jones manager. I was like, who? It's like, Malky. Bro, I know him because, like, in Black Zillions, everybody knew him. Everybody, oh, Malky. So after, like, 10 days, he called me and he went to the gym and I explained to him my situation. He's like, yeah, because we can try to do something, you know. And I explained to him, listen, I never had a manager. You have to, like, you know, you need to help me to do something different in my career now. And then everything was feeling, I was thinking, I was talking to him, and he was talking to One Championship, blah, blah, blah. So, this fight against Okami, I told him, listen, I will not fight, because he was coming from three losses, right? The last three fights, he lost three fights. And then he would fight in Tokyo to retire, would be his last fight.
Right.
Why I would fight a guy like that?
Yeah.
It makes sense. You know, like, if it was Muay Thai, I would fight. Because in Muay Thai, we don't care about our record. We just fight. But MMA is different. I know, like, more wins. Maybe, like, if I go to another place, you know what I mean? Like, would be better to build my record.
Right.
And it wouldn't be, like, if at least the money was good, I would fight him. So it was the same course, right? So I didn't fight. And after that was like a big fight, me and one championship, a really big fight, like bad, you know. And 2 months ago, I was training Gilbert for his fight in UFC. And he fought Tyron Woodley, right? So I was training him for this fight, Muay Thai. I was helping him Muay Thai. And I remember this day because Chachi called me. Chachi, Matt Hume, and my manager, Malky. We had a nice talk. Nice talk. I explained to him everything. The same thing I am explaining to you, but I explained to him everything about my kids, about, like, you know, I had to fight against Nick. Like, bro, I don't want to say what happened against Nick, you know, but it was bad. Like, I didn't need to fight. Well, I shouldn't fight, you know. But what happened, they kind of, like, forced me to fight. You know, like, it's like long history, like, was bad, really bad. So he didn't know that. And he's like, Cosmo, I apologize. I feel so bad about that. I'm so sorry, blah, blah, blah. So I feel like, I felt like, man, he didn't know. He tried to explain, like, Cosmo, more than 100 fighters. I cannot, like, follow everybody, every fighter, like, close, you know, like, things happen and I don't know what happened. So I was like, okay, Charger, that's fine, that's fine. 2 months later, nothing changed. And then I started getting mad because, man, come on. Like, after the call, I thought everything would be, like, good. We would make, like, a new deal and everything would be good. And then I got mad, of course, and I started talking about that on the internet. Like, a Twitter, I was talking about that on Twitter. And last Saturday, he called me, him, same thing, him, Matt Hume, and my manager. And he started, like, things like, I thought everything would be good. This is not my fault because I have a team, you know, like to fix all the situations. And he thought that's what he said. He thought after these 2 months, we should like, they would do something and fix the situation and I would still fight again. But he didn't know. So he's like, I would never do the same thing like, you did, like, go on the internet and say bad things, blah, blah, blah. But I understand. You know, I understand you, man. And then I explained to him, listen, I'm 2 months after that first call. I'm 2 months waiting for some answer, you know. And we are just fight. I don't like that. He's like, no, I understand. So after that, I understood it wasn't his fault. You know, like, maybe he should, like, make sure we would close the deal. You know, but he didn't do it, and I was mad. You know, like, things happen, and I think, like, he tried to close a deal on salary, and I was kind of, like, happy. Just, like, few things I want to put a little bit more in this contract, but probably you close this contract, like, this year, or this week. I will sign the new contract, and I will still fighting there, probably, not sure, probably.
Okay, that's good news because I think you know, I think people that are fans of ONE really want to see you excel at ONE because I feel that they have a really great roster of ONE Muay Thai fighters, good kickboxers, and you know, decent MMA guys, and I think you belong in competition with some of the best fighters. You know, I hope that you guys can reach an agreement. I think the fans want you to reach an agreement as well. But, you know, if it's not fair, I hope you could find a way to make it fair. So hopefully you could keep us in up to date with the contract and stuff like that. I just want to know what would make a good contract for you right now. What would it take for you to be 100% ready to re-sign with them?
I don't know if I can say what I need, you know, but of course, it's not about the fights, how many fights, because I can't still fighting. Like, my body's 100%. I am not enduring anything, you know, like, never get hurt, like, bad. So, probably you'll make, like, 6 or 8 fights, contract, probably around there, 6 or 8, and 2 or 3 years. And the thing I want is like a better purse, you know, like because I'm of the guy, I'm kind of like a fighter. I don't need to build anymore my name. Everybody knows me, like Muay Thai, kickboxing, everybody knows me. And MMA world is different, I understand. But I just beat one of the stars from the show. You know, like, right. Of course, they brought Sage to be the star, right. You know. And but it was a bad match, you know, for him. Right. They didn't believe I could do that. But who knows me from Muay Thai, who knows me from kickboxing, they knew would be a bad deal to match this fight, you know.
Right.
But anyway, and now it's just about money, you know. It's just about money. But I really want to fight. I really want to fight. And the one thing I told in the interview I did yesterday, I'll tell you now. I don't care where I fight. I don't care if it's one championship, UFC, or Bellator. I don't care because as a Muay Thai fighter, I don't think about. I don't care about status. You know, like, oh, UFC fighter. Oh, I don't care about that. But what I care is, like, being fair about the contract, you know, like, paying, like, fair. Like, oh, yeah, I deserve that. You know, that's what I deserve. So if they keep saying, like, what they do and they accept what I ask the last, I will sign the contract this week. You know, and I still fight in one championship. Blah, blah, blah. And probably they will make shows in U.S. soon. And that's amazing. Yeah. Bro, yeah. Travel to Asia, every single fight is just terrible, man. It's like 3 hours trip, man. 30 hours trip. Like, you want to sleep and you have to be up because you have to do photo shoot, you have to do interviews, but you want to sleep. And then at night, you should sleep, but you up. You're like, you know, talking on internet. Man, that's terrible. But, Brian, they will make sure here.
Brian Popejoy and Janet Todd tell me the same thing, that it takes a while for them to just get out there and cut the weight and get ready, mentally prepared. There's a lot of media you guys have to do and stuff like that. So I want a couple of fans asked me, they wanted to know about the Sage Northcutt fight. And
yeah,
what was that like, and what did you see? How did you see the opening when you knocked him out?
I knew he would change his mind if it was stranger. Yeah, I knew he would, like, he would take me down after the first kick or after the first punch. I knew. So I was waiting to see, like, if he didn't do like any crazy shit, like spinning shit, like, you know, like karate stuff. I was worried about that, so I was keeping the distance. But when he started stepping back, it was like, oh, that's good sign, you know, like. So I was trying to keep with the left in his body. I would kick like hard. So I wasn't I think I was in the center of the ring, and then I switch. He stepped back, and I switch again, and he keeps that back. He went to my left, and I cut the way. I didn't chase him, you know. I just cut the ring, so he couldn't step to the left anymore. So I made him go to my right, you know. So I would kick, because I stepped to the left. I cut his way to make him go to the right, because I would kick with the right.
Right.
But was too close. When he stepped by his side and I stepped too, I felt it was close. It was like, oh, I have to punch because he's going this way here. And when I stepped to the cross, he stepped in with the jab, you know. So I would get him anyway, but I think it was like I broke all the bones and all these things because he stepped at the same time, you know. So he stepped with Jeff, and I did an overhand, and I got him. I remember I felt like he's dropping, and I tried to hook the left hook when he was dropping, but I didn't get him. And then I just punched a few times when he was on the ground, just to make sure he wouldn't stand up. And that's it.
You know, after the fight, I think you showed a lot of class, and you went on the internet and you said, you know, we put our bodies at risk and this is just a fight. Sage is a good human being. I'm a human being. We do this for your entertainment. What made you say that to the public Because you didn't have to say any of that stuff. You know what I mean? You could have just been quiet, enjoy your victory. But what made you come out and say that after the Sage Cup fight?
Yeah, because, like, bro, was just, like, crazy how many people was, like, talking trash about him, you know? And I was like, that's not fair, man. That's not fair because he's not my enemy. He's just the fighter who wants to do his job, like me. You know, like, I don't want to, everybody when I go and fight, I don't want to, like, hurt nobody, like, bad, you know? I don't want to, like, oh, I'll kill you. I don't, that doesn't work with me. Probably most of the Muay Thai fighters and kickboxer fighters, no kickboxer, but Muay Thai fighters, we are like that, you know? I remember when the WMC made a show, the Contender, Muay Thai show. You joined for, like, Yotes and Clyde were there. And I remember the president, like, Mr. Fox, saying, we want to do the Contender too, but nobody wants to watch because Muay Thai, everybody's about respect.
Yeah.
People want to see, like, people try to punch each other, you know? So, like, if somebody say something bad, like, oh, I'm sorry. And right. We are like that, you know? We are like that. So when I fought him and I saw everybody, like, talking trash, man, I have to say something, you know? And then I post, I think you saw, right? I post something on my history. And I didn't know he was with the problem in the face, you know, with the bone and everything. I didn't know. But, yeah, I think that's the way it has to be, man. We have to make the difference, you know, like, in a good way. We have to make the difference.
Yeah. I think that was awesome. Very noble of you. You know, and people don't understand that you guys put your bodies at risk for our entertainment, for a sport that really some people don't really get paid that much for. So it's really nice of you to say that. Another question I had was, what was it like training with the Black Zillions? How did you get to train with them?
Yeah, it was nice. I was going to live here in Florida. And I knew a Thai guy. We trained together on a super pro camp, right, in Thailand. And he was here. And, like, he trained me to fight, what his name? Petrosian. So he was my coach there. And he said, Cosmo, if you come here to live in Florida, I know a team you can train. Because I know a manager, like a manager, he wants to build a team. And he has Rashad Evans already and a few more guys. I was like, oh, man, that's nice. So when I came to Florida to train with him, I was living in Massachusetts. So I went to Florida to train with him to prepare for my fight. I met this guy. It was Glenn. So I met Glenn, and Glenn started, like, explaining to me what, like, the things, you know, like, oh, yeah, I want to build a team here, an MMA team. And I told him, listen, I'm just looking for a place to train, you know, like a good train. That's what I need. He's like, oh, here you'll be good. Just, like, believe me. Go fight in Italy and come back to Florida. I will take care of you here. So when I came back, I started training was with maybe like seven guys. It was like me, George Santiago, Jesus, Yuri, Danilo, Rashad. And Anthony Johnson and Michael Johnson was just eight guys. And Black Zillions didn't have name yet. It was just like we were just training. And I remember one day we were training and Danilo said, look, like Danilo was talking with somebody. And it's like, look who is training now. All black guys or Brazilians. And then from there, he got the name, you know. So, and then we started training. It was amazing. You know, after a while, the team grew, like, too much, you know, so wasn't the same. But until, like, 10, 15 guys was nice. It was very, very good.
When did Tyron Spong come into the Black Zillions? Were you able to train with him at all?
Yeah, we trained there. We trained a long time in the Black Zillions. And then we trained together boxing with Pedro Diaz.
Yeah,
he was my coach too. Yeah, and what else? Yeah, it was this, like, we trained, like, I don't remember when Tyrone came to train. I don't remember, and I don't remember why. But anyway, it was good training with Tyrone. It was really good, man.
Yeah, man. He's dope. He's one of my favorite fighters as well. Big guy. Another question was, what do you feel is the big difference in athleticism between Muay Thai and Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu?
Wow. Well, Muay Thai is simple, you know? Low kick, body kick, head kick. Low kick, you know, deep knee. Of course, that is the small things you have to learn to make the, like, the knee, like, powerful knee, or the right time to do the elbow, or the technique, or the technique about the clinch. You learn a lot, and that is a lot of things there. But do you know how many techniques about an arm lock? Like, one arm lock, there's so many things you can do different. You know, like, it's like, change so much, bro. So that's harder to understand, like, small things, like, change like that. So it's hard, bro. It's like, it's different cardio. You know, I prefer training with gi. I don't like no gi. I like training with gi. So, it's totally different. It's totally different. It's crazy, man.
How long have you been doing jiu-jitsu now? When did you start doing jiu-jitsu? Before you got into MMA or while you were doing Muay Thai?
No, 2009. When I started thinking about to fight MMA, yeah, I started training jiu-jitsu. But I was training in Brazil, and then I came to U.S. I was training with a good guy here, good Brazilian guy. When he left, and I started training with a guy from here, wasn't the same. Like, I was like, oh, you know what? I'm just spending my time. You know, like, I'm not training jiu-jitsu anymore. So I'm like 90 years, and I still purple belt. You know, so but it's not natural. I'm not natural jiu-jitsu.
You so another question was, what was your favorite fight that you either won or lost? What is your favorite fight that you like so much?
Favorite fighter?
Your favorite fight that you were a part of. Your favorite
fight. Okay. Let me see. I don't know, man. I think I guess Petrosian was a good fight. It was kickboxing. And it was my first time I was doing 155 pounds without put IV, you know? It was just like, oh, yeah. I do 155 and just like, I will eat and I'll be okay. But I wasn't okay. It was like,
that's
really bad
for you, bro.
Yeah, my weight was 153 something. I checked my weight, 153. Yeah, it was bad. But let's see. I don't know, man. I had so many fights because, like, I never remember the fights I won. I never remember, like, oh, but the fights I lost, I remember almost every fight, every single fight I lost, I remember.
Okay, so I have a better question for you then. Who do you want to rematch?
Rematch? I don't like rematch. Like, the guy beat me up already. Why are you fighting him again?
I think you and Nikkei need to do part three.
Yes. I can't say that because for me, I know how I felt when I fought Nikkei. I know I wasn't 100%. I was like 50% in that fight. I'm not saying like, oh, yeah, I will fight him, I win. No, I'm not saying that. I'm just saying if I fight him in a normal weight or in another show, and he wants to fight 77 kilos, I can fight 77 kilos, like 170 pounds. I can do it.
Right.
Would be more like challenge for him. Would be like more like the fight would be like closer, you know? The way I fought was just like a beginner fight him, right. You know? That's the biggest thing about what happened that fight. You know, they knew I couldn't fight, but I had to fight, you know?
Right.
So.
Right. I also want to see you rematch Joe Nanawat. If you can do that at one, I think that would be a good fight too.
Oh, you know,
MMA
I
gloves
think...
too.
What? What's that?
MMA gloves with Joe Nanawa.
Oh, yeah, that would be nice. But you know, which fight would be really nice? Yeah, I start thinking now, and I wish I could do it. Petrosian, but Muay Thai.
Yeah, that's gonna be hard though. With one, I don't know if he would do that. You know, I haven't seen Petrosian fight Muay Thai in ages, you know what I mean? So you'll have to do it in kickboxing again. Would you do it in kickboxing again?
Yeah, I can do it. I can do it now. Like I know how to recover my weight and everything. Yeah, it would be much better. Another
question that I have is, how did you get into rugby?
So when I was living in Thailand, I was always watching like rugby on TV because they have like an Australian channel.
Yeah, and New Zealand channel.
So I was like always watching, but I never think about like never thought about like play. But when I went to Brazil in 2014, one of my best friends was playing rugby. And I was like, man, I didn't know, man. Like, you play rugby? He's like, yeah, I play rugby. Well, let's play. I say, you think so? He's like, yeah, I think you like it. And then my first training, bro, was just crazy. It was, like, so much fun. I was hitting guys. And that, man, it was, like, crazy. Like, fight, you know? And the coach said, bro, you are natural. You know, you're not afraid to hit and get hit, you know? So, yeah, come to the team. You can enjoy the team. I was like, man, that's amazing. The team was really small team. And then I was just crazy about golf, man. I love rugby. I was crazy about rugby. I was like, I still in love with rugby. And I was watching all day, training all day. It was unbelievable. 1 year after that, I started training one of the best teams in Brazil. Or like one of the best three, you know, in Brazil. So I play with them like two more years, I think, and then I have to move to US.
Wow. Okay, so last question for this interview is you can say anything to your friends around the world that don't understand the things that you have went through your career, what would you tell them?
About like the things, one championship and everything.
Yeah, just, you know, your journey.
I don't know, man. It's like, I'm blessed, you know? Like, even with these things, it's kind of like small things, you know? I want everything what I want. Like, all the tournaments I fought, I won. I won the each Showtime. I won the King's Cup. I'm World Muay Thai champ, like WPMF. I won the WACO World Champion, too, I am. WBC Intercontinental Champion. I don't know, man. Every single tournament I fought, I won, you know? So, I'm blessed. And I'm not hurt. My body's 100%. I almost don't get hit in the face. That's most important because I want to, like, retire and good, you know? Like, thinking and doing my stuff.
Yeah.
I always fight, like, try to fight smart. You know, I fight. I don't brawl. You know, that's, you know what I mean. Like, I like to fight. I'm a sniper. You know, like fighting. I'm not a Rumble. You know, shooting everything. So, this thing about one championship is fixed already. Probably this week I will sign the contract and then I will start fighting again. And I was still fighting until I feel like, oh, you know what, my body just don't wanna do that anymore. Now, I know my body can keep going fighting, you know. My mind sometimes like, you sure? You know, like, you sure? You could be here on the beach all day, but you have to train to play, you know. But I understand that because it's like almost 20 years doing the same thing, you know. You know, like when you fight Muay Thai, it's always the same thing. You run, hit pads, hit bag, clinch. Next, the afternoon, you do the same thing. The next day, the same thing. So I'm tired, bro, like about that. You know, like, yeah. I can fight. I like to fight, but I hate training now. I don't like to train at all. But, of course, I know that another guy is trained to beat me up. So I better I train. That's the only thing I have to do, train and then fight good, you know. So that's it. Like, I still fighting too. Like, I feel really like 100%, still feeling like 100% to fight. But at the end of the day, like, I feel like, you know what, it's not even about money. It's just like, I will retire. And I, God willing, I'll be like, healthy, that's the most important, you know. And that's it. But I how I told you, like, I'm blessed, bro. Because Muay Thai, I know, like, so many people around the world. Like, I made, like, so many friends. Like, you from California. If I wasn't fighting, like, I would never, like, met, you know.
Right.
So, like, I have friends from New Zealand, in Japan, and Amsterdam, like, bro, around the world, you know. So, yeah, I'm happy with my career. I'm blessed. If I retire today, I'll be just, like, happy, you know. I did, like, so many crazy things in my career. Like, so many good knockouts. And it'll be, like, forever people watching. Like, oh, it's Cosmo, you know. So that made me happy.
Awesome, man. I just want to thank you for your time and doing this live interview with me. I think our fans learned a lot, and you got to speak your truth about all the things that are going on. You did accomplish a lot, man, and I know a lot of fighters look up to you. You're some of the favorite fighters for a lot of people that have gotten into Muay Thai and MMA and kickboxing, and I just want to thank you, man.
No, bro. I have to say thank you, and I appreciate all the support. Me, you know, like, doesn't matter if I lose, if I win. I know, like, there's a lot of people like you always supporting me, and I appreciate that, man. And, you know, like, anything you need, bro, just, like, message me, call me. And I hope to see you soon. After this COVID crazy shit, I will see you in California.
Oh, yeah, but tell the fans about your app, bro.
Oh, yes, man. You will, bro. Yeah,
I forgot about that. In the app. I was like, I got to promote the app, too.
Yeah. So, like, I have an app, Cosmo Alexandre Academy. I upload like one video per week, right? One video every week about techniques, about the techniques I do in my fights, about the techniques like I like to do, you know, like in the train and teach people. It's all the techniques I like, and I know how that works, you know. I know that works. So it's, you can download on your iPhone or your Android. It's $5 per month, the normal membership, but the premium is $10. The premium, the difference is we have like giveaways. I will do some videos with some like big names in the Muay Thai or MMA, like I want to do with Kevin Ross. Yeah. I did already with Gilbert. I did with Cyborg, you know, like, so if you are premium, a member, you have like a membership like premium, you can see these videos. You know, that's the biggest difference. Like, you'll be nice. After the COVID, like, when we have, like, a normal life, you guys, you see, like, so many, like, big names doing the techniques, and, you know, you'll be nice. And that's it, man. It's like $5, bro, $5 per month, and you can see the techniques. And now, with nobody can go to the gym and blah, 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 you can train, you know, in your house, watching the videos, and that's it.
All right, guys, so make sure you check out the app. Go to the App Store for your Android and iPhone, and it's a Cosmo Alexandre Training Academy, correct?
Cosmo Alexandre Academy, yes, yes. Yes, good. All right,
thank you very much. Have a good night.
Thank you very much, man. Talk to you later. Bye. Yeah, rapaziada. Que é? Pena que não tá entendendo nada. Vou deixar o outro aqui. Meu irmão, meu irmão tá de boa agora. Mas demorou. Valeu, rapaziada, por assistir aí. A gente se fala mais tarde. Valeu, de repente faço uma live aí daqui a pouco ou amanhã. Valeu, a gente vai se falando. Abraço, rapaziada. Boa noite. Valeu.